Hello. Did you know Einstein's famous equation E equals mc squared is responsible in a nuclear power station for converting a little bit of mass of the uranium into energy? We may not know that, in fact, a little bit of mass is converted into energy in a whole number of different nuclear events. In particular, I'm going to talk first about alpha particle decay. In an alpha particle decay, the alpha particle is spat out of the nucleus at high speed. Where does it get that kinetic energy from? Well, if we look at the accurate masses of all the bits involved, you'll find that there is a mass defect. As a little aside, these masses are measured in U, atomic mass units, and you need a mass spectrometer in order to measure those so accurately. The mass is bent by a known magnetic field strength, and depending on how much they bend, we can determine exactly how massive they are. So back to this decay equation, we can work out a mass defect, and we do that by taking the mass on the left-hand side and subtracting the mass on the right-hand side. That gives us a mass defect of 6 times 10 to the minus 3 U, or atomic mass units, which we can convert into kilograms by the conversion factor. Now, by E equals mc squared, you multiply that mass in kilograms by the speed of light squared, and you get 9 times 10 to the minus 13 joules, which is not a lot of energy in joules, but it is a lot of energy for one alpha particle because its mass is so small. Now, this photograph taken by Cockcroft and Walton in the 1930s shows lithium being bombarded with a hydrogen ion. So, in other words, a high energy proton. I think the proton comes down from above, and two alpha particles are created. So, here's one, and I think that might be another one. The proton's been accelerated through 800,000 volts, and so it has a kinetic energy of 0.8 mega electron volts. Don't forget the charge on a proton is the same as the charge on an electron, except positive. Now, the alpha particles can measure their energy by how far they travel in this gas, and they were measured to have 8.5 MeV each, and there were two of them. So it's clear that quite a lot of kinetic energy gets created. The only other energy would be the thermal energy of the vibrating lithium ion, which, as it's just vibrating in solid form, would be less than an electron volt, so it's almost negligible. Now, the mass of these particles is given by here from mass spectroscopy, and remember that we know the conversion factor for atomic mass units. So let's just look at some of the numbers. Well, is kinetic energy conserved? Clearly not. I gain two lots of 8.5 MeV, and I only started with 0.8 MeV. So I've got an increase of 16.2 mega electron volts. Let's just put that number here. And I've converted that number into joules. Now, if we look at the mass defect, you'll find that I actually lose. I've got a little bit more mass here than I had here, and so I've got a mass defect of 0.02909 U, atomic mass units. Now, let's take that mass defect, convert it into kilograms with the conversion factor, and then apply E equals mc squared, and you will see that I gain 3.1 times 10 to the minus 12 joules. Converting that into electron volts gives 19.5 me mega electron volts. So, mass defect gives us an extra 19.5 MeV, and I can see I've increased my kinetic energy by 16.2 MeV, i.e., the mass defect supplies the extra kinetic energy. The remaining kinetic energy could be lost in other forms. And I'll leave you with Einstein talking on the same topic. Now, Einstein, of course, predicted this a long way before the 1930s, 1932, but it took a while before it could be proven or demonstrated experimentally. And so here's him talking on that topic.
It follows from the special theory of relativity that mass and energy are both but different manifestations of the same thing, a somewhat unfamiliar conception for the average mind. Furthermore, the equation E is equal mc squared, in which energy is put equal to mass multiplied with the square of the velocity of light, showed that very small amount of mass will be converted into a very large amount of energy, and vice versa. The mass and energy were in fact equivalent, according to the formula mentioned above. This was demonstrated by Cochran and Wolfson in 1932 experimentally.
Hope that helps.